pastor has been sharing with us, it reminded me of this verse in 1 John, in the 4th chapter, starting at the 2nd verse. This is how you can recognize the Spirit of God. Every spirit that acknowledges that Jesus Christ has come in the flesh is from God. But every spirit that does not acknowledge Jesus is not from God. This is the spirit of the Antichrist, which you have heard is coming, and even now it's already in the world. You, dear children, are from God and have overcome them, because the one who is in you is greater than the one who is in the world. Just find that so encouraging to remember as we look around us and as we think about things that are coming, that he that is in us is greater than he who is in the world. So let's stand up this morning. We're going to praise God and acknowledge who he is, the mighty one.
Certainly had challenges that we have faced this week. difficulties. But Lord, you are greater than any problem that we face in our country, in our personal lives, in this world. Lord, you are stronger than anything else. So we acknowledge that, Lord. Let faith arise in our hearts this morning. May the words and the message and the prayers and just the fellowship of the body of Christ, may we be strengthened in our most holy faith this morning. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
You can be seated. Feels like fall out there. Isn't that great? Loving this. Good to have you this morning. Good to see you. We have 20 ladies from our church and school on retreat. So we're missing a good group of our faithful ladies this morning. But I trust that the Lord is still with them and blessed them mightily today. They're leaving. In fact, probably right now they're on their way back. And speaking of leaving, Kathy and I are leaving right after church to go to Canton. We have a church health team meetings. And we'll be back Wednesday around noon. One other mention is, if you haven't heard, Joyce Butler passed away. Those of you who know Joyce just know what a special Christian lady she was, and she will be greatly missed. But I had a chance to actually see her. She died Saturday morning at 8:54, and before going to men's breakfast around 7:30, I stopped just to put something on her window, a picture of Kathy and I, for her to look at. And her drapes were pulled. They're almost always shut, and you have to call those people and have them open the drapes to see her. But they were open, so I got to look in at her and have a little prayer for her right at 7:30. So it was the last time to get to see Joyce, so that I was really glad I had that opportunity. She's a very special person. So her service is going to be at Bennett Funeral Home. The viewing is noon to 2 on Thursday, and then the service at 2.
All right, so just a few things to point out through the bulletin or information. We will have a business meeting immediately after the service next Sunday. It'll be short, but just one piece of business about the nominating committee that we need to attend to. Also, you know, we have an annual mission trip to Kentucky. So far, it has not happened yet this year, but Lord willing, it will. Right, Jeff? So we've got postponed to October. Those dates have been changed to November. But Lord willing, we will still have a Hanover Friends presence in Kentucky at some point in 2020. So keep looking in the bulletin for that. We've been talking about our kids fellowship things, kind of sort of rebooting, restarting. So Wednesday night starts this coming Wednesday night, and then Sunday school will resume October 11th. So that info is in your bulletin. And then last week I made a little bit of a plea for some student ministry help. I know it sounds lame, but we need people to help count bags. And we use about 450 bags every Tuesday night, and we have depleted our store of them. So it doesn't sound that fun, and I'm sure it's not. But if you don't do it, then in addition to all other things that have to happen on Tuesday night, somebody there has to do it. So if you could maybe think somewhere along the way during your week, you could just count some plastic bags, let me know, and I will put you to work. All right? We have a couple of other special announcements, so Susan's going to come first.
Good morning.
Good morning.
So, thank you for the opportunity just to share about some information about some upcoming events. Like many of you here today, I have been so filled with thoughts and emotions and questions about the things, the events happening in the world around us. What God is saying to me, what God is saying to my family, God is saying to the church, to the world. And as I've shared these thoughts and feelings with some of you out there, many of you are thinking and feeling the same thing. And especially with what Pastor Ed has been preaching, just kind of came to a head last week, and I went to Pastor Ed, who pointed me to Kim Sutherland. And bottom line is, during the week, with the help of Pastor Ed and Kim, and Pastor's wife, Kathy, and Lisa Workman, we put together some information for you. There's a flyer in your bulletin. I just want to draw your attention to it. And there's more information out in the foyer. I'm hoping that you will take a look. Many of you know about this. but we're trying to see how we can plug into this, how you as a Christian can be a part of what is happening. Christian leaders around the world are gathering because they recognize this is a critical part in the history of the world. So please take a look. If you have any questions, share it with your leaders here at the church, and opportunities are there. And so I want to challenge you with that thought in mind. Yesterday morning, I inadvertently ran across an interview with Jim Caviezel. Most of you may remember that he was the gentleman, the actor that played Jesus in The Passion of the Christ. And he's just finished up another movie, which happens to be about the persecution of Christians around the world. He's dedicating his time to making people aware of this because he said he feels this is not a time for Christians to be comfortable. The things going on, we have to take a stand. We have to be brave. We have to seek the Lord and say, Lord, what do you want me to do? So when he was sharing all of this, he shared a quote that I've never heard. Many of you may be familiar with it, but it came from a speech that Ronald Reagan gave in 1964. I believe, if my research memory is correct, it was for a speech for Barry Goldwater. But 1964, but this is what it said. You and I have a rendezvous with destiny. We will preserve for our children this, the last best hope of man on earth, or we will sentence them to take the first step into 1,000 years of darkness. If we fail, at least let our children and our children's children say of us, we justified our brief time here. We did all that could be done. I don't know about you, but those are words just said, if for me, no words could be more relevant for today's world, for what is God is wanting to do and calling us to do as Christians. I leave you with this challenge. Read through the material. Seek the Lord and say, what part am I to play in this rendezvous with history, destiny? Thank you. God bless you, and I appreciate your time.
So, what Susan was referring to looks like this in your bulletin. All the information is in here. So yeah, we'll be meeting here Friday night if you're interested. Also, Saturday, Franklin Graham is hosting a prayer meeting in Washington, D.C. Lisa Zimmer was just asking us about that. We don't have anything specific ironed out as far as like going there, but I think several of you are, so if you're interested in carpooling or that kind of thing or meeting there, you know, we would definitely encourage that. But so yeah, make sure you're paying attention to these kind of things and opportunities that we have to engage what's happening in the world. All right, we also have another sort of special speaker today. So some of you know her, but Ashley Boshin is the director of our Friendly Care Day School. And so she wanted to come today to share some of the things that are going on in life in school.
Like Pastor Charles said, I know some of you, at least I know your faces, but I would love to strengthen that connection between this church and the day school. Currently, we have about 114 kids in and out of our building, which is lower than it has been in years, but we have made it through the COVID season. We have stayed open, praise the Lord for that, and just been able to continue to love kids and love their families in a season that has been tough on all of us. So I'm just truly thankful for all that this church does and continues to do to support the day school. But we also have a couple of things that I would love more support with. There's a cute little apple in the announcements, or the friendly tidings, I should say. And we are going to be putting up a tree in the hallway. One of our artists, our teachers is an artist over on the day school side, and she's going to create a tree that will allow you to pick off apples or oranges, and that will have certain things that we could love and we need on the school side to help support our pantry. You know, it takes a lot to feed little people, and we love to do that. So if you could help with that, that would be great. That will hopefully be up around October 1st. So just feel free to pick off whatever fruit is on that tree and bring it back. We would love to have that. The other thing is we will be running a fundraiser in the month of October. We're selling those discount cards to local businesses. So feel free to stop by and pick up one for $20 a piece. and all that money goes to support the school. So we just would love to have your support a little bit more. And like I said, I'm glad I can be here and so you know my face and know that we are continuing to love low people over there. So thank you all so much.
Can you stand? We're going to continue worshiping. This is kind of a response song, but feel free to sing every word of it. It's called Is He Worthy? And after hearing pastor's sermons, I mean, we know the answer to that. There's only one word in it, and it is Jesus Christ.
Thank you.
precious than silver or gold, that is beyond value, what we can even understand. You are worthy to lay down your life and then be raised again. By that resurrection power, the Father raised you again on that third day, and you took away sin and death, the sting that it has, that we may be given the opportunity to live with you forever in eternity, to worship the Father, praise the Son, to dwell. It's hard to imagine sometimes what that will be like without any evil, without any selfishness, without any of the sin that ties us down and so easily entangles us here, Lord God. But you have already provided the remedy. Speak into our hearts right now, Lord God, and reveal to us the parts of us that need that remedy right now, today, Lord God. Thank you, Jesus, for you are so worthy. We love and praise you.
Only ever you shall be ministered. Worthy of all the praise before you. Worthy of every breath before you. And you for you. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever save. Worthy of every breath we could ever give, even for you. Thank you.
is an invitation to you. If you would like to come forward and pray, perhaps the Lord has been just speaking to your heart and touching you deeply as you've been worshiping Him. And if you just feel the need, the desire to come forward, please do and kneel at the altar. This weekend. We pray for our sick, those who need a healing touch today, that you would minister to them and do that, and those that are dealing with COVID both locally and across this country and world, that there would be healing for those individuals. We pray for Joyce Butler's family and her friends that are grieving her loss. Lord, we know she represented you well here as a believer, and we have great confidence that she's with you and not suffering any longer. But Lord, we do miss her, and her family will miss her. I pray that you will just touch them with your love and comfort this morning. Think of our teachers and students and parents who are adjusting to new routines and a new way of doing school, those that are going to public school and maybe even private schools. Lord, that you would help them, give them strength and grace and patience, and just may that go well, and children and teachers became safe at their schools. We pray for those impacted by Hurricane Sally, that they will receive the help that they need to get their lives back together. Lord, I pray for a change in the Chinese Communist Party, that you would work there, that some of them would be born again, that you would not let evil reign in that country. And bless Jerusalem with peace, as your word asks us to pray. We pray for the upcoming election, that it would be fair and honest, and that, Lord, there would be a squelching of riots and division and unrest that just seems like Satan wants to stir up so badly, especially with Justice Ginsburg's death and just threats of burning everything down. We just pray that that will not happen, Lord. We pray for our country, and we know that you're hearing prayers and voting up, and as groups gather over these next months to pray, would you hear from heaven and bring a needed revival to our land? And it was mentioned our Wednesday children's program restarting, so we thank you for Jeff and Casey doing that, and Lord, we pray that you would bless them as they bless our children, and our children will continue to hear about you, both in our church and in our day school. Thank you for Ashley being with us and her leadership and her love for our children and our school. And we know, Lord, that you are our provider for both our church and our school. And so we lift them up to you and trust you. In Jesus' name, amen. And children, I'm going to dismiss you at this time. You're free to go on to junior church. I'm in the book of Revelation, and we have come now to perhaps the most famous chapter in Revelation, chapter 13, Nick, one of the most famous chapters in the Bible, actually. It has the beast and the false prophet, the mark of the beast and the number of his name, 666, and the unholy trinity of Satan, the Antichrist, and the false prophet. Two beasts are described in this chapter. One is political and the other religious in nature. So to understand what a beast is, you need to understand it is kind of twofold. One, it is an anti-God political and economic system. And secondly, it's a person who leads or heads that political system. So let me say a few words about the political system before we talk about the person. I believe that the last human government will be one that's totalitarian in nature and will be a one-world government. Just a brief quote here of a much longer quote. For many years now, there have been numerous analysts, economics, and geopolitical experts in the alternative media that have predicted and warned the public about the global strategy of order out of chaos. In other words, the ultra-wealthy power brokers that hold influence over most of the governments on Earth seek to reshape the existing social order through the creation of crisis and disaster. By engineering public desperation, they hope to lure us into accepting restrictions on our freedoms that we would have never considered otherwise. The goal of a single global economy and government has been spoken of by elites time and time again, yet it is still to this day called conspiracy theory or paranoid delusion. I could quote these elites and their organizations all day long, but I'll cite a few choice statements to make my point. And then the writer here goes on to cite those from back from the 50s forward to today, many, many times. This has been spoken of. I remember George H. Bush, the first Bush, talking about a new world order coming. And that's what is, I think, going to happen in the last days government. Genesis chapter 11 describes the first anti-God unity government under a man named Nimrod. They spoke one language and had one mind with the desire to build a tower to heaven and thus rule God and man. But God scattered them, you remember from the story. So I think the last government is going to be Babylon revisited. Revelation chapter 17 and 18 talks about Babylon again in those terms. There's a long history of governments craving power and abusing it. We could look at the world empires in ancient history, like Egypt and Assyria, Babylon, the Medo-Persian Empire, Greece, Rome. These were all biblical empires that in some way dominated Israel. And Israel itself desperately wanted a king so they could be like the other nations. 1 Samuel 8:7. And the Lord told him, "Listen to all that the people are saying to you. It is not you they have rejected, but they have rejected me as their king." We want a king. We want a ruler over us rather than God. And so the tendency of governments is because they have the power of the sword, they abuse it. God gave governments the power of the sword to judge rightly, to punish evil, and to reward good. And he gave them the law, his mind, and natural law to govern truthfully and in justice. But they end up craving that power and abusing it and try to replace God. Within the last 100 years, we could look at examples like Hitler, Stalin, Mao, Pol Pot, just to name a few. God eventually judged Nebuchadnezzar of Babylon, who ate grass like a cow, or King Uzziah of Israel, who attempted to light incense in the holy place and got leprosy, or Herod, who was praised as a god and died suddenly. In Acts 12, it mentions that. On the appointed day, Herod, wearing his royal robes, sat on his throne and delivered a public address to the people. They shouted, "This is the voice of a god, not a man." Immediately, because Herod did not give praise to God, an angel of the Lord struck him down, and he was eaten by worms and died. So God knows how to judge kings and kingdoms. So the anti-God political beast system is in place. It needs a leader. The world is full of problems, and so a man of peace arrives on the scene with supernatural ability to solve problems. And the Bible says the world will follow him. He'll fool everyone and change into a beast. So who is he? Well, many believe that he is alive now. And I suppose that's possible. He could be. I've kept track of articles I've read over the years listing possible candidates for the Antichrist. Some of them in ancient history, so some of these works are very old, who said this is who the Antichrist is. Some right up to the present. Here's some of the names I've compiled. Nimrod, resurrected. Judas. Nero. Caligula, Domitian, and any host of Roman emperors. Popes from the Middle Ages till today, Hitler, Mussolini, Stalin, Kissinger, Jimmy Carter, because the initials JC, Juan Carlos of Spain, because of the JC, Gorbachev, remember that mark he had, that birthmark on his head, said he was the Antichrist, Ronald Wilson Reagan, because his three names have six letters each, so 666, a Christian televangelist, a leader of the European common market, a New Age guru, a Jew from the tribe of Dan, a man from the northern part of the old Grecian Empire, a Syrian, an ISIS leader, Turkey's President Erdogan, former President Obama, he's got a lot of traction lately, President Trump, a woman to fool everybody, a hybrid disguised as a man, and a Muslim Antichrist Mahdi, or 12 Iman. So you can see from my list, there's been a lot of guessing going on. And unless God personally reveals his identity to you, you're just going to have to wait until God reveals his identity. And while there's some good types in that list, there are two people that I think have been the best, closest types of the Antichrist in history. The first, Antiochus Epiphanes. He was a Syrian general in the 2nd century, I think, BC, who conquered Israel and set up an image in the temple and sacrificed a pig on the altar. The prophet Daniel predicted that this man would come and do that, and Jesus actually mentioned it. The other type is Hitler. He was a charismatic speaker that attracted a great following. He was into the occult, mystery religions, and witchcraft, so he had a special close relationship with Satan. He murdered 6 million Jews. He wanted a 1,000-year Aryan reign to mimic Christ's 1,000-year millennial reign. Germany had a lot of troubles after World War I, and he solved economic problems and united the country. And I think a future Antichrist will do the same. So there's a Christ. It's logical there would be an Antichrist, which can mean against, but it could also mean instead of. And Jesus warned us that there would be many false Christs in Mark 13:6. Many will come in my name claiming I am he, and will deceive many. So one day we'll know his identity. And my goal this morning is to not for us to try to figure out his identity and who he might be. I want to read through Revelation chapter 13 and just let the Holy Spirit speak to you as I read this chapter, and then I just want to go back and hit some highlights. And the dragon stood on the shore of the sea. And I saw a beast coming out of the sea. He had 10 horns and 7 heads, with 10 crowns on his horns, and on each head a blasphemous name. The beast I saw resembled a leopard, but had feet like those of a bear, and a mouth like that of a lion. The dragon gave the beast his power and his throne and great authority. One of the heads of the beast seemed to have had a fatal wound, but the fatal wound had been healed. The whole world was astonished and followed the beast. Men worshipped the dragon because he had given authority to the beast, and they also worshipped the beast and asked, "Who is like the beast? Who can make war against him?" The beast was given a mouth to utter proud words and blasphemies and to exercise his authority for 42 months. He opened his mouth to blaspheme God and to slander his name and his dwelling place and those who live in heaven. He was given power to make war against the saints and to conquer them. And he was given authority over every tribe, people, language, and nation. All inhabitants of the earth will worship the beast. All whose names have not been written in the book of life belonging to the Lamb that was slain from the creation of the world. He who has an ear, let him hear. If anyone is to go into captivity he will go. If anyone is to be killed with a sword he will be killed. This calls for patient endurance and faithfulness on the part of the saints. Then I saw another beast coming out of the earth. He had 2 horns like a lamb, but he spoke like a dragon. He exercised all the authority of the first beast on his behalf, and made the earth and its inhabitants worship the first beast, whose fatal wound had been healed. And he performed great and miraculous signs, even causing fire to come down from the heaven to earth in full view of men. Because of the signs he was given power to do on behalf of the first beast, he deceived the inhabitants of the earth. He ordered them to set up an image in honor of the beast, who was wounded by the sword and yet lived. He was given power to give breath to the image of the first beast, so that it could speak and cause all who refused to worship the image to be killed. He also forced everyone, small and great, rich and poor, free and slave, to receive a mark on his right hand or on his forehead, so that no one could buy or sell unless he had the mark, which is the name of the beast or the number of his names. This calls for wisdom. If anyone has insight, let him calculate the number of the beast, for it is man's number. His number is 666. Okay, let's go through this chapter. The dragon is mentioned first, which Revelation says the symbol of the dragon is Satan. Revelation, if you look through the book, it'll oftentimes define what the symbol means. So the dragon, Satan, stands on the shore of the sea, and he saw a beast coming out of the sea. I take this to be humanity, coming out of the sea of humanity. Revelation 17, 15 says, then the angel said to me, the waters you saw where the prostitute sits are peoples, multitudes, nations, and languages. The sea is an apt symbol of the agitated surface of unregenerated humanity, and especially of the seething cauldron of national social life out of which the great historical movements of the world arise. So just out of the mass of humanity arises this beast. He has 10 horns. The dragon also has 10 horns in Revelation 12, verse 3. So he's closely connected to Satan. Horns in Scripture stand for power and authority. It's probably 10 kings or 10 countries here. Now, I've read over the years this could be the European Common Market, but then it grew to more than 10 nations. Or 10 regions of the world. Or a 10-nation Islamic confederation. 10 emperors. Or 10 rich men, billionaires, with the proper bloodlines. The Illuminati. Or just simply 10 is a symbolic number. 7 heads. Again, closely connected to the dragon, Revelation 12, verse 3. 7 is a symbolic number of perfection, so it could just be perfection of evil. Is this referring to the 7 hills of Rome, 7 emperors, 7 governments? Probably 7 governments that align themselves, or 7 countries align themselves with the beast. 10 crowns were on the horns, right? So crowns on the head of the dragon, we also see that in Revelation 12, which means political authority. And on each head was a blasphemous, profane, proud, anti-God name. John continues to describe the beast, and he represents a leopard. Now, we have to go back to Daniel's vision of empires in Daniel 2 and Daniel 7. So there's a parallel passage that describes what these animals are. The leopard represents the Grecian Empire under Alexander the Great. He conquered the world fast in just 2.5 years. And we see that the Antichrist will have 42 months. Well, he'll have a short period of time. And so he moves fast and conquers fast. He has the feet of a bear, probably a reference, according to Daniel, to the Medes and the Persian, that empire, which was big and powerful and unstoppable. And then the mouth of the lion probably refers to Babylon, that empire. So I think what John is seeing here, he's seen a combination empire of the beast system that's going to take the most powerful and evil aspects of ancient world empires to be combined into one mighty empire at the end of the age. His kingdom contains the others. So if we look on our map, we would see that that stretches from Eastern Europe to India, which is largely the Muslim world today. He will receive his power and throne and authority from the dragon. Again, he's satanically inspired. I personally believe that Satan will possess this man. He will be a combination, therefore, of human and demon. It mentions a fatal head wound. Now, this is really hard to interpret. If it's a kingdom that's referred to here, then that makes the most sense. A kingdom was destroyed either in the past or in the future, and then arises again. Could it be Rome? Could it be the Ottoman Empire? Possibly. I don't know. Or it could refer to being a resurrected dead past leader. Many thought Nero would be resurrected and rule again someday. Nimrod, I've also seen that name. Or it's the future Antichrist will be assassinated and resurrected. Just think if President John F. Kennedy came back and was alive again. Everyone would marvel at that, and that would That would get their attention for sure, and many would think he's a god. So if it is the Antichrist person referenced to with a fatal head wound, and I'm not sure it is, it would certainly be a type of Christ's resurrection, a fake resurrection, an attempt again of Satan to copy what God does. When Jesus rose from the dead, the Pharisees said, it's a lie. And when Paul proclaimed it, he was told to be mad. But when the Antichrist rises, if it is a person, the world is amazed. The whole world is amazed. That says to me, the whole world, that this is a was a future happening that the whole world would see probably on television. Maybe on Fox News or CNN will cover it. It says in the text that the people worship the beast. Satan always has wanted worship. Remember when he was tempting Jesus in the wilderness? Jesus said to him, away from me, Satan, for it is written, worship the Lord your God and serve only him. But now Satan gets his wish. He is worshipped, and the Antichrist is worshipped. Who is like the beast? They should be saying, who is like God? And his reign is short-lived, just 3.5 years. He wages war against God's holy people and conquers them. The book of Revelation is very clear. At the end of the age, Christians will be persecuted and martyred for their faith. Satan hates Jews, and he hates Christians because they won't worship him or the beast. The whole world is impacted. We have seen in these last years Muslims killing Christians over in the Middle East, so it's not something that's unthinkable. And persecution is gradually beginning here in our country. So let me admonish you today to have the mindset, I will persevere in my faith no matter what. I will put my faith in Jesus Christ and be loyal to him no matter what. And I will courageously accept martyrdom if that's God's plan for me. Then John sees a second beast coming out of the earth. Notice it's the earth this time, not the sea. This is a different beast called the false prophet. And Jesus warned that there would be false prophets in the last days. For false Christs and false prophets will appear and perform signs and miracles to deceive the elect, if that were possible. So the false prophet is the religious arm of the Antichrist political economic system. The first beast, the Antichrist, is political. The false prophet is religious. In the first century, so in John's day, there was the imperial priesthood. These priests, their job was to get people to worship the emperor. So, who is it? Who is the false prophet? If you read the reformers, like Calvin and Luther knows, of course it was the Pope. And a lot of people have thought it's the Catholic Church and the Pope will be significant at the end of the age. And I have looked and listened to and read much of the current Pope, Pope Francis. I personally think he's more of a Marxist than he is a Christian, but that's my opinion. And he has compromised on many occasions with Islam. And so my personal belief is this end-time religion will be a compromise of the major world religions. It had two horns, like a lamb, and spoke like a dragon. So its chief characteristic is deception. He looks harmless. He looks nice and saying nice, good, religious sounding things, and he's a counterfeit lamb of Jesus. He has no crown on his head, so again, he's not political, he's religious in nature. His job is to force the world to worship the first beast, and the deception is so strong that people will. We saw that in Mark 13:22 and Matthew 24:24. The false Christ and false prophets will appear and perform great signs and miracles to deceive the elect, if that were possible. So he does counterfeit miracles. Always test miracles. They still occur. God still does miracles in this world. But these miracles will be done by the power of Satan to deceive. Some kind of an image of the beast is made, and people will be forced to worship it.
pure idolatry. It could be placed in a future rebuilt temple in Jerusalem, but the image seems to come to life. And with the technology we have today, that's not hard to do at all. We could use holograms, computers, artificial intelligence. So the job of the Christian will be to refuse to worship this image. Be like the three Hebrew children in the story of Daniel who would not bow down and worship the image of Nebuchadnezzar, and of course were thrown into the fiery furnace. The false prophet is involved in marking people. All classes, no one is exempt. I like to say we'll go from the mask to the mark. And the word mark is used only here in Revelation. God marked his servants in Revelation chapter 7 on the foreheads, but the mark of the beast is the foreheads or the right hand. He copies God. And that word means a physical mark, insignia, scratch, or etching. So it could be something that's outwardly seen, but I think it could be something that isn't seen inside. It could be a visible tattoo, but I think it's going to be something invisible, like a microchip, or an RFID chip, or a DNA implant, something that might change our DNA. And so I've been keeping my eye on something called ID 2020. You may want to research that. Something that could, in the future, be a platform to administer vaccines that everyone is forced to take, but also puts other information inside of you to track you. And because it's inside your body, it can't be lost or stolen, so there is something ingenious about it. In the ancient world, slaves were branded. Those people were someone's property. So people who worship the beast will be Antichrist's property. He owns that person. They won't be able to buy food, travel, or work without taking this mark, which makes them a part of the beast system. So keep your eye on a worldwide change in the monetary system. That's something I'm watching. The Great Reset of 2021. You might look that up. We are moving, whether we like it or not, away from a cash-driven society into a cashless society and eventually to a digital one where if everything is digital, every purchase you make will be able to be traced and tracked by the government. It could be, you could be refused services. So again, just let me admonish you. If you're alive during this time, starve, die, do not take the mark. Revelation 14 tells us, a third angel followed them and said in a loud voice, if anyone worships the beast and his image and receives his mark on the forehead or on the hand, he too will drink of the wine of God's fury, which has been poured full strength into the cup of his wrath. He will be tormented with burning sulfur in the presence of the holy angels and of the Lamb. And the smoke of their torment rises forever and ever. There is no rest, day or night, for those who worship the beast and his image, or for anyone who receives the mark of his name. Just keep this in the back of your mind if someday it's a reality. And then verse 18, 666 is mentioned. Now, even unbelievers know about 666 from the movie The Omen. Remember, little Damien had that 666 tattooed in his scalp. John says, to understand this, you need insight to know the meaning. And I feel like there was probably little doubt that John's readers in the first century understood this. But even by the second century, Christian writer Irenaeus had no idea what it was. Now, believe it or not, when I was a young Christian and I read this, I thought, I wonder if I'm the Antichrist, because my three names had six letters each. But then I thought for a moment, I thought, well, so does my dad's. So maybe my dad's the Antichrist. And then our son, our oldest son, three names, six letters. So no, I don't think that's what it means at all. Even though the Jews did have numerology, where numbers stood for things, like the number three, eternity, and four, the world. The number six stands for man. 7 is God's number, the number of perfection. So 6 falls short of God. So when you would put 3 6s together, that would be the epitome of fallen humankind, the epitome of human evil. And perhaps that's all 666 means. It's just a symbolic number that means the epitome of human evil. But Hebrew letters also stood for numbers, just like our alphabet. A would be, could be 1, B 2. And you know, you just add up the letters in your name, and what number does that make? Interestingly, in Hebrew, Jesus' name adds up to 888. And Nero Caesar's is 666 in Hebrew and Latin. So perhaps John had this in his mind as a reference to this Roman emperor, that someday there will be a type of Nero, someone like him someday. All I would say is it'll be clear when the time comes. It's very hard for us to try to figure it out now. Finally, the Bible says that Jesus destroys the Antichrist and the false prophet at his second coming, Revelation 19. Then I saw the beast and the kings of the earth and their armies gathered together to make war against the rider on the horse and his army. But the beast was captured, and with him the false prophet, who had performed the miraculous signs on his behalf. With these signs, he had deluded those who had received the mark of the beast and worshipped his image. The two of them were thrown alive into the fiery lake of burning sulfur. So the last government of mankind ends at the second coming of Jesus Christ as he comes to establish his righteous kingdom on the earth. Well, Lord, this is a challenging chapter to read and understand for sure, and you know that. But you can give us wisdom and insight to understand at least the basics, to know that government can be evil and can want the power that should be rightfully yours. We've seen that throughout history, and undoubtedly it will happen again. So let us, Lord, keep our eyes on Jesus, not on any king, not on any man or ruler to save us and deliver us. Lord, our eyes are on you. You are our king. You are our savior. If we walk closely with you each and every day of our life, we're going to be okay. We're going to make it. You're going to deliver us to your heavenly throne, and we will rule and reign with you forever. We have such a wonderful future ahead of us. But Lord, help us to be faithful while we're on this earth, to live for you and to speak for you. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Would you stand?
As we've been hearing these kind of hard teachings, hard truths, I thought about this song, "Let the peace of God reign in the midst of every hard part of our lives. The peace of God can have control over it, and he can reign in our lives."
Oh,
your peace, the peace of God that is beyond understanding at times. Lord, let it rain on us today, this week, and forever. In Jesus' name, amen.